This is Sunday, March the 12th of 2023, but it's also Adair 19 of 5783. Okay, so everybody remembers that 5783 sounds like a lot of years, but biblically, that's the number of years they can mark from the day that Adam and Eve left the garden. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
That's interesting. And God does a lot of things when he's bringing about revelation to us. So this is the month that, just so we can all remember what this month is about, this is Adar. This is the last of the months before we start the new months. And in this month, this 12th month, these are the things that the Holy Spirit wants you to be looking at, working on, figuring out what's missing or not missing, so that you can be closer to God. So here are a few of them. This is the month that you're supposed to find your true identity, spiritually and physically. Now, that sounds really good, but you have to do some work to find your true identity. Because most of us have been raised forever, and we've agreed with our false identity, who the world says we are, who our parents said we were, who our peers say we were, etc., etc. And we never ask, Holy Spirit, what's my true identity? Well, I got messed up in that. So literally, this month, he has a spiritual open heaven above you that literally says, I'm pulling out everything I can for you to hear what your true identity is. And it's your job to just reach up and get it. So that's your job. That's what you're here for. Now, what you're going to find is a lot of things that you liked about your false identity. He may let you know that's not you. I remember arguing with him when he showed me a piece of me and he said, that's not from me. I go, but I'm good at it. And he goes, it's still not from me. Do you hear what I'm saying? So some of the things you take so much pride in that you are, might not even be from him. So you need to ask those hard questions and do it. Another thing, this is the month to overturn worry. Does anybody in here happen to every once in a while give in to worry? I'll give you a secret. Worry is a sin. Okay, let's just call it what it is today. Worry is a sin. I was raised in a family that if you wanted to show your love for each other, you showed how much you worried about them. Do you hear me? Mm-hmm. Do you see how that messes up your love definition? If you think you have to show how much I'm worried about you. Did you call me when you got home? Did you straighten this out? Did you do that? I'm worried about you. And in my family's definition, that meant we loved you. Mm-hmm. Now, if we didn't worry about you, we didn't love you. You see the sickness in that, right? Uh-huh. Okay. This is the month to overturn worry through a release of supply. This is the month that you're supposed to develop your war strategy. War strategy could be taken in a lot of ways. It could be taken as the things that God wants you to war against that's evil in your life. Or it could be taken as he's just wanting to give you a war strategy on how to find your identity. So he's trying to give you some help this month, giving you some strategies. This is a time for any decrees or words that were spoken over you to be broken. You may not realize, and some of you may, you remember when that teacher said, oh my goodness, go sit down, you're stupid. I'm just using an example. What you didn't realize is that's a word curse over you, and you've come into agreement more or less the rest of your life. It changes lots of things. This is the month that he's going to remind you of decrees or word curses that people have spoken over you. And he's going to say to you, stop them. This is how we stop them. And he's going to say, forgive that person and remove the effects of that word curse. And what the enemy meant for evil, you're going to turn to good. Just by remembering Mrs. Clandestinewater in third grade said that evil thing to you. Do you hear what I'm saying? There's a lot of those memories that do these decrees and these word curses that we're not aware of. This is also the month that the roots of depression and despair break through into faith.
Yes.
Depression and despair is a frequency that the enemy is hovering over the United States. Mm-hmm. Can you sense it?
Mm-hmm.
And if there are any roots in you, in other words, if there are any generational things or things you've agreed with that are in you, when that frequency comes, you pull it down. And you become depressed over things you didn't even want to be depressed over. You become in despair over things that you didn't even think you cared about, because those roots are deep inside of you. So all of this is so that we can start seeing what's over us for this month. So how do we do these things? How do we find our identity and our overturner strategies and hear what God's saying and do that? We do it by the principles and the patterns that God has given you. I say to you guys a lot, we're supposed to be going up. There's a mountain of God. It's like here we are on this level, and up at the top is God's destiny for us, his purpose, and we get it all together at the top, okay? But what happens is most of us in Christianity, we go around the interstate highway that's on the bottom of the mountain. And we just go around it, around it, around it. We complain about traffic. We do all these things, but we just keep going on this highway. And we never actually take those steps to move or spiral up the mountain, okay? To spiral up the mountain, there are moeds, M-O-E-D. It's literally a time or an appointed time for you to leave the interstate and to go up this narrow path or up a different way so you can spiral up the mountain of God. Now, some of you have tried to just forget those and just try to climb up the mountain of God, you know, like rock climbing, and you've not been successful, okay? You've fallen down, you've hurt yourself, the enemy came against you because it wasn't your timing and it wasn't the way God wanted you to do it. But we decided, I'm going up this mountain and everybody else can just move out of my way. That's not how God works. He's a God of patterns. He's a God of timing, and he's a God of cycles. And that's what we're going to talk today. Because when you go up this mountain of God, what you're actually doing is following his cycles of blessing. God is not a linear God. He does not say, okay, we're going to start here, and on 3 months, you're going to stop this. I mean, if you really be honest, very seldom does God say, okay, this is when we're going to stop. Because we as Greek-minded people want to know when we stop, and I've said this a million times, I can do anything if you'll tell me when the end date is. If I have something I can hang on to that tells me this is all going to be done when I get there. That's not God. Because God is a God of faith. And to do that, he's probably going to need you to exert your faith to trust him that we'll stop when it's ready for you to stop. I think there are more variables in the stop date than you and I imagine. For example, if we participate as fast as he wants, we might stop on the date. But what if you don't participate as fast as he wants it? Then he has to extend the date because you're still not playing, okay? And so he has to keep dragging it out and dragging it out. So again, when we enter into this blessings, when we do that, what we're literally trying to do is go up higher on the mountain of God. To do that, you've got to either link with or agree with these cycles, these blessings. I don't remember any time in my Christian walk as a young girl that someone sat down and says, God has cycles. I mean, that would almost be, you know, what were you thinking? God's not like that. But I began to do, he has cycles. Now, they're not meaningless rituals. That's different. I don't mean you to say that. But when we do God's cycles, we produce change. And change is what we're all after, to go up higher. So over time, we're supposed to keep spiraling up this mountain. We're supposed to be going up into these higher cycles. It literally leads you, as you go up these mountains, it leads you to your destiny. It leads you to your purpose. So I can literally almost see sometimes you guys in different levels on that mountain. I can see where this, you've come up a little bit higher, but this has kept you from going any higher, this particular mindset or this thought. It just stops you right there. So you just go around the next highway, you know, on that level, and you don't spiral up. So the end result, if we follow God's cycle, is that we're supposed to experience different dimensions of His glory. So God uses all kinds of cycles. He uses these to give you His blessings. And if you don't see the cycles, then you won't always recognize it's a hit and miss on the blessings because you don't know where to enter in. So let's think of like a natural cycle for God. And in the natural realm, He's got a principle called sowing and reaping. How many of you have ever heard that? Mm-hmm. Okay. Sowing and reaping is a natural cycle. So in other words, you sow, you tend the crop, you harvest it, then you sow again. And it's just a repetitive cycle. And what ends up happening is every time you do that cycle, you get blessed more. Every time you enter into that cycle in a greater way, in agreement with Him, you enter into a higher thing. It's why He has us do this repetitive thing. A lot of times people say, well, all the people, the churches, all they want is my money. Have you ever heard that? Mm-hmm. They just want my money. They want to see if I'm tithing. They want to see if I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. They just want my money. Okay. Well, in this place, Gary would probably like to have your money. But it is not dependent on your money how much you got hugged. Okay. It's just not. Because what we have learned, and Gary and I had to learn it the hard way, probably like most of you, is we were in a season in our early marriage where money was almost non-existent. Okay. It was like constant thinking of what can we do to get money to have this need met or this bill paid or whatever. And we had both been raised in church, let me make that clear, but it had never been equated to us that if we gave something as silly as the tithe, that suddenly we would have protection. Because you see, when you do that commandment that's talking about giving a tithe, giving an understanding, what God is now allowed to do is to protect all your money. And we could not figure out how, we didn't have enough money to pay bills. How are we going to have enough money to pay bills in a tithe? Because you don't think like that. You think, okay, I don't already have enough, and you're wanting to give me 10% about stuff I already don't have enough. But what you have to understand in the cycle of God, what He has said to you is, if you give me this, I can now protect all the rest of your monies from being stolen by the devil. So we began to find when we did that is that no longer were things happening like the car breaking down, the washing machine breaking down, the electricity being more. Do you hear what I'm saying? Suddenly, that 90% was more than enough to cover the bills that we couldn't cover with 100%. Because now the equation of God came in and His blessings come in. So cycles happen like this so that we can get. So you got to do the action. The result was every time we did it, we got multiplied and increased. And I can remember Gary laughed about his accountant, his tax guy says, I don't really get you guys. I think he thought we were selling drugs or something. He goes, I have no idea how you guys are giving this much money away. You don't make that much money. Do you hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He's like, it's not making good sense here. Okay, where are you getting your money from? And we would just be blessed. We'd be more than more and blessed. There was a season, okay, that Gary went through when our company, and, you know, again, I'm just sharing honest truth with you. Gary can tell you more details than I could, but there were seasons when, as we were building our company, we actually did not get a salary. I mean, years, right? How many? I don't remember how many years, but it was a lot. Okay. Talk about using your faith when you don't get a salary and you're still trying to live, pay for teenage people, et cetera, et cetera. But supernaturally, we did. Do you hear me? Supernaturally, all the bills were paid. We had more than enough. And we got to build and grow the business. But we had to get to the mine because we paid everybody else first, right? We were the last. We owned the company. And there wasn't enough money for it. But what God supernaturally did is taught us about the cycles of sowing and reaping. Do you realize that Gary still tithed even though we didn't get a check? Are you listening? Are you listening? He says, well, this is what we would have got. So this is what we tithe. I need you to change your thinking so you can understand the new levels of increase every time you go through that process. Now, the sad thing is the enemy has cycles as well. Okay. I've watched many of you get trapped in cycles. You get a little bit of relief or you get a little bit of wisdom and you stop it for a season. But before long, you become weary again and you fall right back into the same trap, into the same cycle, right back into the same way of thinking or processing or doing things like that. So what God is wanting you to understand that the enemy has very much got cycles planned for you. And if you are not aware of them because your identity is not in where God wants it, you will just stay in those patterns of repeat for generations. I've watched poverty destroy generations. Okay. And the people may have money, but it's still a poverty mentality. And because of that, they cannot be blessed. They cannot go into increase because they've agreed with the cycle from the enemy that they are in poverty. And when you agree with that cycle, you don't break out. But if you lock into God's cycles, you end up with some growth and some blessings and some things. So I'm going to talk today just a little bit about one of the cycles that we're going to talk about, but I'm going to introduce you to three of them that you may not recognize that God's done this so that you can have a way to break out of the enemy's cycles. God creates cycles to show you how the enemy is bringing his cycles into your life. The first cycle is the weekly cycle of Sabbath or Shabbat. Okay. Shabbat is the Hebrew word for Sabbath. That's all it means. But there is a weekly cycle. God specifically said there is a weekly cycle for the Sabbath or Shabbat. And we'll talk about that later. He also gave you monthly cycles. Monthly cycles of first fruits. What we call Rosh Kodesh. When we sit here and recognize the new month is coming. It's not to be captured in legalistic Hebrew stuff. It's to bring you into the cycles of blessings that God has for each month. But if you aren't aware of it and you don't recognize it and you don't literally participate in first fruits, then you've stopped yourself from entering into that cycle. I can highly point out to you that if you're not in God's cycle, chances are really strong you're in the devil's cycle. And you don't see it because you don't recognize God has a monthly cycle, a monthly thing. Then he has a yearly cycle that marks the things like the feast and appointed times. Those cycles are designed to take you through key steps to deepen our walk with the Lord or God. And it's to release the power of God and to experience his blessings. So we're about to come up onto the cycle of Passover. Okay, there's a real cycle in Passover. It was meant to remember. It has very powerful things. When it was first introduced to the children of Israel, it was a shadow of what was coming. We now have that cycle complete because Jesus did all that. But if you don't recognize it and put it together, if you don't remember to thank him for this cycle and to thank him for getting us to this next place, then you miss that blessing. You miss that yearly blessing of resetting yourself, to being thankful and grateful to God. Okay? So the cycle I'm going to talk to you today about is Shabbat or Sabbath. It's God's blessing is supposed to come to you in a Sabbath in the middle of your battle. Okay? That's how you have to think of it. So I want to read Hebrews chapter 4. And in Hebrews chapter 4, and everybody keeps telling me I keep giving wrong scripture, wrong dates, wrong time, so keep me straight. My brain is talking and my mouth is talking and they're on two separate cycles. And sometimes I don't get them connected, okay? I'm trying to get ahead. In this chapter 4, it literally talks about two kinds of rest. One is the rest where he's literally talking about a physical rest for you. And the other one, he's talking about resting in the finished works of Christ, or learning how to do what some call dominion rest, learning how to rest in him. Today, we're going to focus on just the first one, Shabbat or Sabbath, so that you can see that. So look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1. Now God has offered to us the same promise of entering into his realm of resting in confident faith. So we must be extremely careful to ensure that we all embrace the fullness of that promise and not fail to experience it. For we have heard the good news of deliverance just as they did, yet they didn't join their faith with the word. Instead, what they heard didn't affect them deeply, for they doubted. For those of us who believe, faith activates the promise, and we experience the realm of confident rest. For he has said, I was grieved with them and made a solemn oath, and they will never enter into the calming rest of my spirit. Excuse me. God's works have all been completed with the foundation of the world, for it says in scriptures, on the seventh day, God rested from all his works. And again, as stated before, they will never enter into my calming place of rest. You know, we have a lot of battles. Some of them are against evil powers and principalities, and the warfare is real. I think so often you don't recognize some of the warfare for what it is. You just think it's life. Okay. I've been reading a lot about a man that had passed here, a really high level, lovely, lovely man, Jack Hayford. And his life was just an epitome of just being that really walked out the character of God. And you can look at his life. And he tells the story that in the very beginning, he had married his college sweetheart. And they were just having a, you know, lovely life and everything was good. And they were pastors at a church. And all of a sudden, another woman came into the equation. And Jack Hayford said it was really hard because the more he was around her, the more he loved her. And he kept feeling this love for her. And he was really struggling because it was almost as if he was loving two women. Okay. Now, there wasn't anything inappropriate that was happening except for all these feelings and emotions and thoughts that were happening. And he would go home and he would lay in his floor every night and just pray in the spirit, asking God, help me, help me, help me. Okay. And he said it was then that he realized spiritual warfare comes in a lot of interesting ways. Do you hear me? You wouldn't think of it like that. But he was in a big battle. He was in a huge battle to stay true to what God had given him and not be deceived by something else. And that's when he began to really seek God on how do you do spiritual warfare. So in the battle, all of us are in battles. Some of us may not recognize they are evil battles. They're hard battles. But he's getting your focus off of what God wants onto something else. So when you're in battle, you've got to be aware, alert, diligent. You know, you can't really let your guard down. Do you understand what it's like? In in different seasons in my life, I noticed that when I was trying to accomplish something, like birth a ministry or birth a school or birth a business or do different things, my intense level would just get higher and higher because I'm one of these people that just, everything's thought out, everything's planned out, 500 different directions. I've got it all, and I don't just stop thinking. Okay. It is impossible for me to just go, I'm not going to have a thought. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm not sure that's totally healthy. I'm just explaining. Okay. Gary is perfectly capable of having no thoughts. And he has worked on me forever. He goes, it's because you have a guilty conscience. I go, I don't have a guilty conscience. I just can't stop thinking. Okay. And so we'd lay down and he'd just be, you know, he's out. And I'm like, okay, I've got to do this tomorrow. I've got to do that. I need to put this together. I got to put the, and I could shut it off. Are you hearing me? And he'd go, so he'd try to teach me techniques. He'd go, babe, just think of it as all handwriting on a chalkboard. Just go and erase it. And then your chalkboard's clean. I go, no. Because immediately I go, what was it up in that corner that was there? What was this? And he'd go, okay, let's try something else. You know, he's been working on me for years. Because there was no way. I was just going to, hit this pillow and I'm asleep. And he said, okay, let's think about all your thoughts. They're in your head. You're going to lay your head on the pillow, and they're going to all just fall out your ear. Remember? He's working really hard to get his wife some sleep, okay, because she just doesn't sleep. And I'd go, I don't know how you can not think. I don't know how you can just clear it, okay, and there's nothing there. I said, even when I clear it, I hold it for a second, and then I go, something needs to be there. And then the next thing I do, I'm writing on it again. Okay. Battles, you always have to be alert and diligent. And what I found with me was I didn't have a down switch, like an off switch. I didn't know how to be off. Are you listening? How to stop. At one season... in my life, I was teaching college level courses. I was training a learning disability center how to take care of children with learning disabilities. I was driving 2 hours a day to my job, okay, 1 hour there and 1 hour back. And I had three teenage sons, and Gary decided that would be a good time to remodel our house. It was a moment. And what ended up happening is suddenly all my energy levels and everything, it was just like I was just drained. And so I went to some different people and I go, well, you burned out your adrenal glands. I go, is that bad? And they go, well, how do you feel? I go, bad. And they go, well, that's what we're saying. You messed them all up. And I'm like, well, what are we going to do? And they go, well, it's going to take time. You have to go, I don't have time. Can you give me the pill for the not the time thing? Because I don't have time. And so God supernaturally began to teach me about a rest. Okay. I did not do rest. On my one day a week I didn't work, I cleaned the house. Do you hear me? Everybody's listening. Okay. And God says, you can't really be on the front lines of life every moment without taking a break. Okay. Even our greatest soldiers can't stay on the front line for months and months and months. It's too much because you have to be alert. Your adrenal glands are like, okay. And when you do that all the time, even though you don't think you're doing it, even people may look at you and you may look like a low-key person. Are you listening? I'm specifically thinking of a few of you. You look like low-key people. Oh, I don't have stress. I'm just laid back. I let the world come and go as it wants. But inside of you, you're like a crazy person. You know what I'm talking about. You fool everybody else, except for those that can see. Your adrenals are on overload. Okay. So we can't be on it. We need that rest. Now, Shabbat, in some denominations, they teach that Jesus has already done everything that he needs to do. He's done his finished work. So we don't have anything to do. We're just resting. Do you hear me? I mean, I'm not trying to tell all the denominations they all got it wrong. But let's just listen. What they're saying is, I don't have any job to do because Jesus already did everything. Mm-hmm. So I have no responsibility. And I'm just going to rest in him and let the world go to hell in a handbasket. Do you hear me? That's what they think. And so when you try to say, well, why did Jesus give us the keys to the kingdom? Well, he didn't give them to us now. I go, yeah, actually it says that. Well, he didn't want us to do anything. He already did it all. I go, then why did he have us pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Do you think heaven looks like what we look like here on earth right now? If it does, then we've misunderstood. So a rest is different. We rest, and that's what we can talk about later, dominion rest. We rest in the fact that Jesus did the finished works. We don't have to go defeat the devil in that same way and get the battle. But we do have to deliver what he has finished into this realm. That's a whole different ball game. That's a whole different thing. So when we look at that, I know he finished it, but he designed it so that we would be the ones to appropriate it. So think of it like this. Jesus is sitting in heaven. He's interceding for you and I. He's got all these victory decrees over everything you can possibly have in your life. Victory over poverty, victory over rejection, victory over finances, victory over relationships, victory over everything. He's already done it. Those victories are setting in heavenly realm in that dimension. And all he's saying to you is, reach up, get that scroll, get that victory, and bring it into this realm so you can tell the devil it's already been done. So you do have a peace. You do have the peace where you have to do it. And when we do that, it's agreeing with his finished work, but it's a battle. Because the devil does not want you to get that victory down here into your life. He absolutely does not. So when we're wrestling with this, when we're being the sheriff and taking the decrees and victories of Jesus and delivering them here on earth, okay, that's what we're doing. We're delivering his decrees. Okay, devil, I'm sorry. Jesus already overcame. Get out. When we deliver them, that's exhausting. Okay. I can literally tell you the spiritual things I go through are so much more exhausting than any hay field I ever worked in my entire life. And I worked a lot of hay fields as a child because that's what we did on the ranch. You would be so exhausted by the end of the day doing your baling and your raking and your cutting and all this. Then you had to haul the hay all night. Okay, it didn't stop just because we got it finished here. Then you just took a break for dinner and you get back in the truck and now you're hauling it at night. The physical things aren't near as exhausting and mentally draining as the spiritual battles you're going to fight. So you've got to realize that's really true. God's design was that man was to work diligently for 6 days. And then on the seventh day, he was supposed to have a Sabbath, a day of rest. It's a special day. It's set apart to rest, to just enjoy God's goodness and his blessings while we kind of meditate on all of the glories that are around us, like in heaven and on earth. He promised great blessings to those who keep his Shabbat or his Sabbath as a holy day, just as God rested on the first Sabbath after he created everything. I remind you, when God did his work for 6 days to create, he did not rest because he was tired. He rested to show us a pattern, because he knew we as the humans would need that day to recalibrate, that day to reset us, that day to put us back in to where we should have been. Because when you're in a war, it starts taking away from you. It starts eating at you. It starts pulling from you. And you're lower down. And so when we get that day of rest, it changes things. So Shabbat is for not only individuals, but for families. I want to make that clear. Shabbat is designed for families. It's a time to rest and be restored. It's a time to set aside for you to savor the goodness and gain the strength to press on through the obstacles in your destiny. So it's a take time to just stop and remember. The word remember is zokar in Hebrew. And God used it over and over again because he knew that if his people didn't remember, they would forget the power and the things that happened. Zokar is a quantum physics word. Why? Because every time you say, I remember this, you are going to that place in time where that event happened. Let's say when we take our communion, we're saying, I remember what you did on the cross. Every time we say that, we are literally taking the power, the victory, everything that was released in that moment at the cross. And we're saying, bring it into me right now. So literally, it's as though you were standing there at the cross receiving that. Receiving the victory, the power, everything. And you've just transferred it because you said, I remember. I zokar that. And I'm taking it into this place in my life so I can feel that energy and that release and all those things. So God designed our bodies so that we would have a shutdown time of rest every day. How many of you understand that the healing in your body actually takes place when you sleep? Mm-hmm. Okay. So if the devil's after your sleep, what do you think he's after? Your healing. So he takes this and he actually does these interesting things. He takes it so that you can't recharge. You can't get to there. I want to read, this is a book that I love. It's called Awaken the Sleeper, and it's by Dr. Nick Castellano. And in it, it talks about what influences your sleep or what influences your rest or your ability to do so. And I just want to read you some of this. It's about understanding the different waves that you think or that you process on so you can see this. Excuse me. It says an EEG is a machine that monitors brainwave activity. There are four basic types of brainwave: beta, alpha, theta, and delta. Okay. The beta waves are alertness and focus and cognition. Beta waves exist at a frequency of 14 cycles per second and above. They exist in a conscious mind. When your attention is focused on the outside world, they are associated with peak conversations, heightened alertness, and visual activity. This is a typical wave pattern of a person in normal day-to-day interactions. The second wave is the alpha waves. It's for relaxation, visualization, and creativity. Alpha waves exist at 8 to 13 cycles per second, and are present during dreaming and light meditation with your eyes closed when you're thinking on God. In alpha, we begin to access the wealth of creativity that lies just below the conscious mind. It is a gateway into our deeper consciousness, and this is the range of waves that the Earth's electromagnetic field resonates. It's called the Schumann resonance. That's why all the, I call them hippies, all the people that are into supernatural, natural things, they go around and walk on the dirt. Do you know why they're walking on the dirt? They're trying to be regrounded with the frequency of the dirt. Okay. Because when it does, it creates these alpha waves in them. Theta waves. Theta waves are intuition, listening to the Holy Spirit, meditations, vision, and imagery. Theta waves exist at 4 to 7 cycles per second, and they are typically in sleep or high meditation state. This realm is for deep thought, when the focus is on the inner self and improvement, not on the outer world. Theta meditation increases creativity, enhances learning, and reduces stress, and awakens intuition in oneself. Isn't that interesting? You know, everything you learn today, you're not learning it right now. You will learn it tonight when you sleep. Did you know that? Everything you're taught in school, you don't learn it in school. When you reprocess it in your sleep, that's when you learn it. But if you can't get to this level of sleep, how much are you learning? The last one is called delta waves. Deep sleep, healing, and detached awareness. Delta waves exist at frequencies from 0.5 to 3 cycles per second. Do you see how it's just slowing down? Really slowing down. Okay. During deep sleep and deep meditation, these waves create a total vacation from our visible world. And they create great peace and tranquility inside the body. Delta waves are responsible for the release of growth hormones, which heal the body. And you all thought you were just sleeping. You're doing the different frequencies. You're doing the different waves. Now, what is God trying to tell us about this Sabbath or this sleeping thing? If you want to change the circumstances in your life, then you have to change who you spend time with. Okay? Let me give you some examples here. I want to go. This world is trying to get you to carry all kinds of frequencies and vibrations. Most of us are pretty clueless, I'll put it that way, as to what the enemy is sending you as far as vibrations. Most of you don't recognize it's the enemy sending you that thought. You just think it's you. You just think you made up that thought. But the enemy is an expert at sending a thought or a frustration or a worry or a vibration into you. I think so often, you know, I'd just love to be able to put you in a cocoon so you didn't feel those vibrations from him and those frequencies for a season, so that you can know what it feels like to be calm and in God. Okay. That's why I always tell you, put your armor on. Put your armor on. And I go, I know you got it on, but you need to make it deeper, stronger, better. And you do that by agreeing with it. Okay. When I put my armor on, I look more like a space cowboy. I think that's what Tammy calls me. I look more like a space cowboy. Okay. Because there is no air from the outside that gets into the inside except for God. Do you hear me? There's no frequencies from the outside that get into the inside because they can't penetrate God. What you don't understand is that we're trying to stay in God's frequency. We're trying to stay in that, but we can't do it because we're not doing the cycles of God. Okay. Shabbat allows you to take a break from the frequencies of the war and the battle. It allows you to rest and put your faith in God to take care of it. Years ago, I was planning a trip for the organization that I was working with, and the man that was supposed to be planning it, this had been a trip we'd planned for about 4 months. And about 3 weeks before we were supposed to go, he called me and he goes, I can't do it. And I go, you can't do what? And he goes, well, I can't put this together. And I'm like, what are you talking about? You know, he's had months. And he said, I don't have any hotel rooms. I don't have the places we're going to go. We have over 250 people coming, and I don't know where to send them, and I don't know how to transport them. And I'm thinking, it's a fine time to be whining, Lucille. And he said, can you do that? And I go, all that? I said, we got less than 3 weeks. We don't even have venues. We don't have ways to... He goes, yeah, can you do that? And I'm realizing that he can't. I'm pretty sure I probably can't either, but he can't. So if we're going to even pretend like we're going to get this done, I started to do it. So for 2 solid weeks, Gary used to laugh. He said, I just changed from pajamas to pajamas. Okay. Because I didn't stop. It was day and night. I was trying to work out venues, get transportation, find them hotel rooms, and figure out how do we put all these 250 people that think we got their acts together with an act. And so it came down to the weekend before we're leaving on Monday. And it was on Friday morning. And I'd still been up for hours. It'd been a long night, you know, and I still had so much left to confirm or get solid. And Holy Spirit says, we are taking a Sabbath. I go, oh, no, we're not. I won't get it done. He goes, we are taking a Sabbath. And I go, okay, so a few hours, I'm just going to go sleep. He goes, no. When evening comes on this Friday night till evening on Saturday night, you may not do a thing to plan, organize, or do this. I'm like, oh, Lord, you don't understand. I can't get it all done. I can't get it all done if you make me stop and rest. You know I'm just going to worry about it while I'm resting. Why can't I just fix it? And he said, the success of this thing is depending if you take a Sabbath. I was crying because I knew I'd look bad. I knew this was going to be public humiliation because they would think we all had our acts together and we would show we did not. And he said, it's up to you. And so he literally asked me, will you take a rest with me? And I said, well, I'll try. In those days, I couldn't, remember, I can't stop thinking. So I couldn't just go sit outside and enjoy nature. Okay. Look at the birds and listen to the bees. That was not happening. So he said, let's fill you with me. So he had me read some scripture. He had me do some walking. He had me just stop thinking about all that work you're doing. Just replace it. And that's all I could do at that time. I couldn't just be, ooh, yay, God's with me. Go. I couldn't do that. And so for 24 hours, I counted them. I was going to take every minute he would allow me to work. For 24 hours, I just refused to touch it because I knew this was somehow important. At the end of 24 hours, I was ready to go. Absolutely everything I had tried to get to work, to fix, to get timing together, when I checked in, it had already been fixed. Do you hear me? So all the work I would have had to do in my humanness to make it happen, he had done in his spiritual power while I was resting. While I was resting. And so literally by Sunday afternoon, it was all together. I'm pretty sure if I'd have stayed in it and hadn't rested, it wouldn't have been. So that's where I'm challenging you today. Are there places that you need to get to that rest? In Psalms 127, it says this. If God's grace, and I'm starting with verse 1. If God's grace doesn't help the builders, they will labor in vain to build a house. If God's mercy doesn't protect the city, all the sentries will circle in vain. So speaking to you guys, it really is senseless to work so hard from early morning till late at night, toiling to make a living for fear of not having enough. God can provide for his lovers even while they sleep. Okay? So rest, as we know, originated as God's pattern. It's his gift from God. He said, work 6 days and on the seventh rest. So it's a choice whether or not you receive his gift. I need you to hear this. It's a choice. So learning to rest is part of all of us. We used to laugh because Gary's choice of life was he worked. If you've ever known Gary in any of his life, I mean, when all the rest of people were going to play, Gary worked. Okay. He actually, I don't know what was wrong with him. He actually enjoyed work. He gloried in work. He felt good in work. Work was his mode, okay? Now, the rest of us were some work, some play. But Gary wasn't a play. Gary didn't know how to really rest. I need you to understand that. So when we were first married, we decided that we wanted to give a gift to our children, something that would help broaden their horizons and help them recognize it's a big world. And what we decided to do was to see all 50 states before they graduated out of high school. Okay. And at the time, you have to remember, we have no money. Okay. So saying we're going to do that, those vacations looked very different each time. I mean, I would save pennies. We would save his change. He would drop his change every night into that. And we would save it up for our fund, you know, for the vacation. And however much change we ended up, that's what we got to spend on vacation. Now, I know you guys find that ridiculous. One year, I think we had $400. And we were going to go on a vacation. And what we noticed is we would usually take 10 days, you know, something close to that, or 2 weeks at the latest, but usually 10 days. And what we noticed with our dad, with Gary, is that he couldn't shift his mode. You know, he couldn't enjoy the vacation. He couldn't rest with us. He was still in work mode. So it would take like 3 hard days to get him, okay, we don't have to fight it. Do you hear me? Because his whole life is about fighting it. It was about challenging it. And after a few vacations, we're like, we need to get him faster into this, you know? So we can, because we loved having our Gary. It was the only time we had him fully. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because work took so much of him. So this is when he bonded with the kids. We had some crazy memories and some lovely adventures. And it was like he was ours, okay? He didn't think about all those other things. He was just ours. And we treasured it greatly to have him with us, even if we were sleeping in the back of a station wagon. Okay, y'all don't understand. It was crazy in those days. But we realized that he couldn't shift to rest. He couldn't really rest. And so when I finally got filled with the Holy Spirit, I realized, Father, help him enjoy your rest as much as your work. Because to him, rest was lazy. Do you hear me? I want to tell you, I have done a miraculous job. You're cured, aren't you, babe? This man is now an epitome of rest. Okay. He probably, you know, and he'll say once in a while, what are we doing today? Nothing. Okay, if we have to. I want you to understand, he had to embrace the rest. He had to see the rest. He had to regularly realize, what does it look like? Okay? You have to trust God. And now, he and I laugh about it. We may have overdone it with the children, just a little bit. Because now they think, if they don't get their playtime in, then we're going to have to move something. Okay. One of them does probably about equal 50 work, 50 play. Okay. And the others have different schedules. But it's interesting how they don't have a problem resting and playing at all. Isn't that interesting? We have all these labor-saving devices. You know, they're supposed to save you time. Oh. Y'all know that? And I do believe, you know, having actually washed my clothes on a rub board and in different places, I could see how a washing machine is actually saving you time. But notice, we replace the time we saved with something else, don't we? And what we think is it doesn't cause a stress what it's replacing, but it does. Work always expands to fill the hours that are available. So I can remember, you know, when Gary and I were first married, we didn't eat out. Okay, we didn't have enough money to eat out. Our children didn't play expensive sports. Okay, nope, there wasn't money for that. We didn't do a lot of social gatherings. Now people feel pressured. If your children aren't in 42 sports, if you're not eating out or grabbing something to bring home, if you're not having these social interactions so you feel validated, those time labor-saving devices have been replaced with something different. So every week you are supposed to rest from your work. Now what that means is you rest from the things you do to be your living, whatever your living is. So if you are a mechanic, what it means is on your Shabbat or Sabbath, you don't mechanic. Okay. If you're a secretary, you don't secretary. If you're a teacher, you don't teach. Now, farmers have a little bit harder time because their animals don't understand that. So they still have to do that. But I have known farmers that put off everything else except for just the maintenance of their animals to do a Shabbat. So that's the first thing you have to do. Do you realize the commandment to rest is there? The number four commandment is what? Remember the Sabbath. Remember, and keep it holy. Failing to keep the Sabbath holy is as much a violation of God's will as killing, stealing, or having an adulterous affair. What? Now see, that doesn't sound sinful to not take a rest. But in God's eyes, it is. Uh-oh. So, by Jesus' time, keeping a Shabbat had become a real ritual. And all the religious people were walking around pretty much with clipboards. Are you doing this? Are you walking too many miles? Are you doing this? And they took away the Sabbath. Jesus, if you look at all the places he talked about the Sabbath, in Matthew 12, they talked about his disciples were eating grains out in a wheat field. And all the religious people going, you can't do that. That's not Sabbath. Okay. And then he would reply to them and he'd say, for the Son is the Lord of the Sabbath. Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. He did healing on the Sabbath. Again, no to the religious people. You're not allowed to heal people. You're not allowed to do these things. And he kept showing them over and over again that the Sabbath was made for man and not man made for the Sabbath. It was quite different. So he's considered the Lord of Sabbath, the Lord of Shabbat. He taught in the synagogues. He taught on the lakes. He taught everywhere during Sabbath. Okay. And they had all these rules and regulations. He even healed many, many people on the Sabbath. That's why the religious people were mad at him, because he didn't follow all their rules that they had made. In the New Testament, in Colossians 2:16, this is what he says. So why would you allow anyone to judge you because of what you eat or drink, or insist that you keep the feast and observe new moon celebrations or the Sabbath? All of these were but a prophetic shadow and evidence of what would be fulfilled for the body of Christ. What was happening is these Jewish Pharisees and Sadducees were coming to these new converts, these new Messianic Christians, and they were coming to them and saying, you're not keeping the Sabbath right. You're not doing the legal restrictions. You're not doing all these things. And he says, why would you let an unbeliever tell you what is truth, what is really going on. So the goal is to restore the Sabbath back to its original design, not to the rules of legalism kept in the Hebraic law that these Pharisees had said. So the original design is Sabbath is that you literally take a day to rest. Okay. So if you start work, it says is you work 6 days, you rest on the seventh. It didn't tell you which day you had to do that on. Now, the Jewish people took their Sabbath on Friday evening. So from Friday evening to Saturday evening was their Sabbath. If you go to Israel today, work day starts on Monday, on Sunday. That's their work day. Now remember when God set this up, Jesus had not yet come. So all those people that tell you that Sunday has to be your Sabbath, okay, it can be. But again, what God's saying is you need a day of rest. If this is your day of rest, great, that's not a problem. But he's trying to show you that if you don't get into his cycles, this will happen. If you miss a Sabbath, you won't go to hell. That's really good news. Okay. He won't send you to hell if you forget your Sabbath. But what does happen when you continually miss your Sabbaths is you'll miss your blessing. You'll miss out on your joy. You'll miss out on your creativity and your strength, because those are the frequencies that happen when you disconnect yourself from the world and you begin to let God come in and meditate within you. If God created the universe in 6 days, he's strong enough to handle your responsibilities for one day while you take a rest and enjoy his blessings. Did you know that? Just like with me. He said, if you will rest, this trip will be a success. I believe it would have failed in a lot of ways if I hadn't obeyed. Jewish people do Sabbath, as we said, on Friday night. You remember we had a guest speaker, Shannon Bennett, that came and told you what it was like in Israel? She said, Friday afternoon, everything starts shutting down. All the businesses shut down, and everybody in the whole nation just goes pause. She says it becomes quiet. Can you imagine America going pause? She said it becomes that, and even though they may not understand the fullness of it, they are obeying taking a rest. So everybody, nobody goes shopping, nobody, I mean, you still have to do the emergencies, but everybody just says, nope, we're just all taking a rest. And they walk, they go to movies, they enjoy their families, they go set in nature, they go do fun things, they go do anything that just makes a family time. They have lots of meals, they come in and have social time with each other. Because there are no rules or protocols. The only rule is do no regular work. Do you get this? So for a long time, what God would have me do is practice Shabbat. And to practice Shabbat, he would literally tell me on Friday evening, you're going to practice Shabbat, because I didn't do good on Shabbat. I mean, I didn't do good. And so on Friday evening, I would say, what am I supposed to do? And what he would do is he would say, I want you to light a candle, bring the light of Jesus into the world, light a candle, and welcome your Shabbat to come in. It's a time where you lay all that other stuff aside. You lay all your worry aside, your judgment aside, your battles aside, and you just take this time and welcome it in. What began to happen is I began to get excited about, this is my legal time to check out. Okay. I can check out and no one can say anything because I can say, God told me to. But I quit returning phone calls, okay, because it was amazing when I started to take a Shabbat, everybody needed me. Are you listening? And God said, they'll still need you tomorrow. I go, but God, that's not a good steward. They, you know, I'll take care of them. I'll hold them till tomorrow. So I'm asking you today, do you take a seventh day of rest? Do you sit there and ask the Lord what he wants you to do? Gary and I used to do that. We'd say, well, what do you want us to do? And for a long time, we would take drives or we would go and do different things because a Shabbat can be a lot of different things for you. What I'm going to do today is I've brought Shabbat candles because I know you all are visual people, and since I have no video, this is as close as we get. Shabbat candles are just something that you can light on your Shabbat. It's evening to evening. So as the sun gets ready to go down on your day of Shabbat, many times now I can't always take Shabbat on Friday evening because I might be out somewhere God has sent me to. But I on purpose find a day to do my Shabbat, whether it's Monday or Sunday or wherever it is. So I'm giving you, and I want each family to take a Shabbat candle to just remember, are you taking that seventh day? If you don't give him the seventh day like that, he can't really protect your six. That's how serious it is. He can't really protect your 6 days if you're not trusting him with that seventh. So I'm encouraging you today to realize that it is a commandment. He wants you to show your trust and faith in him by saying, I'm setting aside every worry I have, every concern I have, every bill I have, every problem I have, every relationship. I'm setting it aside to just let you recalibrate me. Let you get my frequencies back in alignment with you so I can go back and do the 6 days. Okay? So let me pray before we transition to. So Father God, we just thank you that you have a plan. We may not understand your plan. We may not always think it's a good plan, but you have a cycle and a plan. And the cycles of blessings come when we get into your cycles. So the first cycle is that weekly cycle of realizing you are a God of Sabbath, of Shabbat. You are a God who wants to show us, I need to have time with you. You don't have to sit there and read your Bible the whole time. You don't sit there and have to pray the whole time. You can just sit there and enjoy his nature. Let creation minister to you. But you do have to give him that segment of time saying, here I am, Father. Take away all those frequencies that the enemy's put in me this week in my battle so that I can replace them with yours. I can get to those deep levels of meditation. I can get to those deep levels of creativity, deep levels of the imagination that I can go into it with you so that the enemy can't bring me a false identity. So, Father, I pray for every one of us here today that we will take Sabbath seriously and we will recognize that I must do what the Father asked me to do. I must get on his weekly cycle so I can have strength and joy and creative and be ready to do the next battle. Because if we don't, the enemy just keeps wearing us down. And no matter how hard you fight and how hard you try, the enemy will win. Father, today, give us your cycle. Give us your understanding so that we can learn to rest and just be at peace and trust you that you got this. And we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen?
Amen. 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 And we're just going to enter into that rest through these songs. And we're just going to, the glory that he's given to us for last week and for the week to come, we're going to offer back to him. And we're just going to praise him through sound.
God has will, God has planned. I Your glory is so beautiful.
say, do it again. Taking a deep breath and release.
This is the air.
Thank you. word says, the spirit of heaviness on the garment of praise. That's how we thought about
it. Yes. This is how I find my battles. This is how I find my battles.
Don't forget, we're talking about rest.
This is how I find my battles.
Sometimes we lay it down and we let it fight.
This is how I find my battles.
It's when you think you're lost.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Victory hours.
cycle of God. It's a thing He wants you to do every day. What the enemy sins against you, you can come into agreement with it. Keep it. Or can say, no, I don't think so.
Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
I don't think that's a blessing.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's for me.
Yes.
Cool. So I say, no, devil. No. You don't get to bring this to me. You don't get to cause me heartache. You don't get to cause me emotional trauma. You don't get to cause me worry. You don't get me to cause me to hate my brothers and sisters. You don't get to. So Father changes. So today we come into the cycle of rest. Resting in the fact that He's already done it. The battle's His. We just have to do our part and by faith rest in Him. Close us today. Okay, go ahead.
So this is a testimony of a woman who was in the devil's camp for 18 years. And this is her testimony of what she saw when we put on the armor and when they tried to come at us. When I was serving the devil in the realm of the spirit, it was always difficult to fight against a believer who was putting on the full armor of God. The presence of God surrounded them like a hot fire. We couldn't penetrate it. They always had a fire surrounding them. Their stars would shine brighter and brighter, their angels assigned to shield and protect them from us. The spiritual garments they were wearing could not be seen in the physical, but in the spiritual we could see them, and those people were fully prepared for war. They were always risky to start a fight with a believer because it was impossible, impossible to defeat them when they had their armor on. Mm-hmm. They walked with open heavens above them.
Wow.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Receive it.
Yes. Would you just close us today? Mm-hmm. Hear what the Father said.
Father, we admit that it's hard sometimes. It's hard to see the victory. It's hard to walk in hurt and pain. And we need your help. We need you to lift our chin up so that we can look to you and trust that you have the victory in your hands. And the victory's already been won. So we ask for your forgiveness for a lack of faith. And thank you that the victory is yours. We trust that when we are weak, you will lift us up. You will lift our head so that we can see the victory in spite of what our eyes tell us. But our spiritual eyes and our heart can know and trust you.
Give us eyes, Lord.
And we thank you for that. That you want us to see the victory. Give us ears to hear your word, your voice, and not the enemy's. Thank you for a family. Help us to walk in grace, even when we feel like we're hurt, even when we feel like we're alone, to trust and know that we are not. We thank you that you love us more than we could even fathom. We thank you that we can trust you, even when we don't trust ourselves. We love you, Father. We love you, Jesus, and Holy Spirit. We thank you that you guide us. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 And we all said.